Welcome to Breadboarding. This is video 5 in the series of the Nanocomp 6809, making a small breadboard computer. In this episode, what we're going to do is look at the EEPROM monitor software from the original 1981 copy that I've got. And what we're going to do is make a copy of this, burn this into a more modern EEPROM, then we're going to install it into the breadboard and test it. So what we're going to do first is to have a quick look at the circuit diagram. We can see here the clock and reset circuit and the rest of the CPU circuit that we did in the earlier videos. What we're going to do during the current video is add the address decoder. So this is a chip here that takes the top three address lines and provides a low signal for each of the address ranges. And we're using the 1000 range for the memory, 4000 for the peripheral interface adapter, and 7000 for the read-only memory. So the first thing we need to do is to have a look at the read-only memory chip. So this is the original one that I bought back in 1981. It's a Texas Instruments TMS2516, and the 45 on the end of the code here means it's a 450 nanosecond chip. So this would mean if we were trying to run this in a computer running at slightly faster clock speeds, it would struggle to keep up. Now what we're going to do with this is to put it into an EEPROM programmer to read it first, and then we'll be burning into a more modern chip, which is an 8K Atmel EEPROM. So let's first of all, here is my EEPROM programmer. So let's take the original EEPROM, make sure we get the pins the right way around. So the pin number one is at the top there. Let's check it is in properly. Put that down. Now, the software that comes with this is known as XGPro. So this is XGPro. Software is functional. There are updates occur every couple of weeks, every month or so. And occasionally after an update, you will be required to reflash the firmware, so the software updates the EEPROM programmer. But it's been quite a reliable device, and it's also capable of testing TTL logic circuits. So there is an option in here to go into a test mode, and it has configurations for most of the standard TTL logic circuits, so it will tell you whether or not the chip is functional or not. Now, the main issue we have with this program, this chip, is we need to make sure that the configuration is correct. And if we go back to our presentation here, the issue we have is that the TMS2516, which we have here, is not directly supported by this programmer. There is a very similar chip you'd have thought, which was the TMS2716. However, this Texas Instruments chip was unusual, and it differs from just about every other 2716 chip that exists out there. And after doing a bit of research, there is a National Semiconductor, which later became Fairchild, NMC2716 that matches the 2516 pin outs quite well. And you'll see here that the left-hand side of the chips are pretty much the standard layout, but when we get to pins 21 down to 18, that in fact the 2716 has quite different uses for the pins. PD is power down on the TMS2516, so it's a bit like a combination between either an output enable or a chip enable. But from the point of view of reading the memory, then chip enable and power down being 0 volts work almost exactly the same thing. The key thing is here that the TMS2716 isn't a valid configuration. So when we read the existing ROM, we're going to be using a National Semiconductor NMC2716 configuration. So we're going to select the Fairchild National Semiconductor NMC27C16. The chip is already in the EEPROM programmer, so now we're just going to click read. And that has successfully read the contents. Now, once we've read the contents, we can just check it to see if it looks sensible. And now I happen to know that the first couple of instructions at the beginning of the ROM these 10CE1390, I think that's initializing a stack pointer. And if we go down to the bottom, we can see that the last row where we've got 7F0 to 7FFF, the last two bytes are 7D89. Now, 7D89, I also happen to know, is the reset vector for the Nanocomp. So this is the memory address where the monitor ROM starts after a reset. So it looks like we've got all the correct information here. In later videos, I'll be showing you how you can disassemble the binary values in the ROM here and get the assembly language source code out of the ROM. And we'll be able to use the assembly language source code to make new versions of the monitor and to make changes and improvements to the monitor ROM. And that will be coming up in later videos. So what we're going to do now is just to save the contents of this particular file. And we're going to save this to a folder that I'm using for this current video. So we'll go into my ROM video folder, and by default it uses the chip name and the number of pins, but we're going to call this a Nanocomp 6809 1981, and this will be saved as a .bin file. We'll save that. File's been saved, and now if we have a look in File Manager, you can see the bin file. And what I've got installed on my system is a hex editor known as FRHED. It's an open source free hex editor. And we can just check that this file again looks sensible. So you can see here the 10CE1390 is initialize a stack pointer. And if we get down to the bottom, you can then see that the reset vector at the very last address is 7D89. Now, the key thing about this ROM we've got here, this is a 2 kilobyte ROM. So this is taking up sort of two blocks of 1K of memory. So in hexadecimal, 0 to 400 is 1K, and 400 to 800 will be the next 8K. So we can see here that we've got two 1 kilobyte blocks of memory here. And when we come to burn the new electrically erasable EEPROM, the EEPROM that we're going to be using, this is in fact an 8K device. So we just need to be aware of how we're going to do the address mapping. And in fact, what we're going to do is just to put this 2K of existing monitor ROM in the bottom area of that ROM. So all the other unused address bits are going to be set to zero. So now, having saved the original ROM, what we need to do now is to find our new ROM. So I've already looked out the chips, as I've said in the previous videos. So I've got the ROM chip already here. Some of the other components we'll be looking at as we come on to using the breadboard later. So this is an AT28C64B, rolls off the tongue. And that is an 8 kilobyte ROM from Atmel. It's still being manufactured. So what we're going to do here is to unplug our existing ROM and plug in the new one. Make sure we get the pins right way around. And you can see here I've got the chip label. We'll be gluing that onto the chip before we put it into the breadboard. So that's our chip. So now back to, we know that our file here has got the correct ROM. And what we're going to do now is to choose the Atmel AT28C. So if we put in AT28C64B, we can see the Atmel AT64B. So we're just going to choose that one. And you'll see that it initializes the file contents back to FFFF. And if you look down the bottom here, this goes all the way up to 1FF0 because this is an 8 kilobyte ROM. whereas the previous one we had finished at 7FF. Now, one of the key things we need to be aware of on this particular chip, it has the ability to protect the ROM from being overwritten. And if the new ROM has not been protected in any way, if we try and burn new contents to it and try and unprotect it before programming, then it will fail. So we do need to make sure that we uncheck this unprotect before programming. If we choose to protect the ROM when we program it, then we would need to check this. And I have seen some users of this particular EEPROM programmer have had problems with the Atmel AT2864B. And I suspect they weren't aware of this particular issue, because it does appear to work if we do this. So what we're going to do now is to find our file with the data in it. So we've got our Nanocomp ROM, Nanocomp 680981. This is the file we've just created. And you'll see here, when we load this, we're able to determine where we want the start address. So if we decided that we wanted to put this at the top 2K of the ROM, then we could change the offset here to make it burn the data into the upper area of the ROM. But for the moment, we're going to keep things simple, and we're going to just put this in the bottom 2K of the ROM. So we can now see that the unused area is still FFF. And if we go down to about 7, you see 7F0 up to 7FF has got the contents of our ROM. So looks like we've got everything here. So now we're going to need to do is to hit the program button. We've got the unprotect before programming unchecked, and now we're going to hit program. Pretty quick. There we go. So that's all there is to programming the ROM. And what we're going to do now is to go back to the circuit and to work out how we're going to plug the breadboards together to add our ROM and address decoder. So let's clear away our EEPROM first. I'll just put that back in its chip holder for the moment, keep it out of harm's way, and we'll put the original EEPROM back where it came from. Just clear away the EEPROM programmer. What we're going to do now is to put in the address decoder and this ROM. And if we bring back the circuit that we were using the other day, I'm going to leave the no operation data line set here, because it will allow us to make sure that the address decoder is working. But in order to hook up this circuit, what I've designed this layout to try and show is that we've got the address lines going along the bottom here, with a few that need to go up to the higher side. And then we've got the data lines going along the top here, with a few of them needing to go around onto the bottom side of the chip. And I've tried doing buses with breadboards a number of ways, and the way how I'm planning to do this particular version is a little different from before. And what I'm going to do is to put the RAM and the ROM chips and the address decoder in the middle here. We're going to have all the address lines going to the bottom lines here. These two strips here will still be the 5 volts and ground. And then these ones will be A0 down to A11. And above here, we'll have D0 to D7. And then we're also going to have some of these other lines, like the interrupt request, non-maskable interrupt, the e-clock signal, read, write, and reset. In fact, for reset, what we're going to have is the reset line that is output from the reset circuit. And we're also going to have a reset button line, because we're going to need to connect up the reset button from the keypad at some point in time. Doing it this way, the only issue we've really got with these types of breadboards, it's one of the comments in the breadboarding tips about the busboard prototype systems breadboards, is they don't have connectors on the ends here. And you'll see that the little tabs here don't quite butt up to the end here. But that's not really a big issue. generally what I do is to tie the boards together using the power rails. And if you're putting this on a separate board, then you can stick the breadboards down to that in some way. So that's what we're going to be doing. First thing we need to do is to stick the chip labels on, and then we're going to start laying out the board and building out the circuit. Okay, so I've got my component tray here. So I have my address decoder, which is a 74LS138. We have a couple of decoupling capacitors, and got the chip label as well for the address decoder. Then we also have our ROM that we programmed slightly earlier in this video. So first thing we're going to do is to stick the chip label on. It's always a good idea to check the chip label against the pinouts just to make sure everything's okay. And when you're putting the chip label on, the obvious thing is make sure pin one is actually in the correct place. So pin one's at the top of this chip. And all we're going to do now is to look at it from on top to make sure we try and line these up as best as possible. So this particular chip label came from my own chip label sheet, which I used Inkscape, which is a scalable vector graphics package, which I found easiest to put these chip labels together. And I'll post that up on GitHub at some point in time when I put the other files in here. And we can also then see this is the 74LS138 chip for address decoder. You can see the pins are a little bit splayed out, so you're probably going to have to bend those in a little while to get them to fit in the breadboard. And then this is one of Grant Searle's standard chip labels, the 74138. I'm just going to stick that on there as well. Oops. So look at it from the top, make sure everything is great. Okay. So like all these things, if we look at our schematic, kind of gives us an idea how to do it. What I thought about this later on, I really probably need to move this over here and change its orientation, because most of these chip select lines are going to the upper side of the board. So it might just make things a bit neater if this chip was over here and feeding the chip select lines over here. And I also noticed that, as I said about the A0 to A12 in this particular case can all be a bit confusing. The A11 line, in fact, should just be going to 0 volts, because we only want A0 to A10 to have a 2 kilobyte address range. And because we're only going to be putting the monitor ROM in the bottom 2K, we always want the chip to only use the bottom 2K of ROM. So I'll again update the circuit diagram. Again, the advantage of having the diagram printed out like this, you can make these sorts of corrections as you go along. So first thing we need to really try and do is to work out how best to lay all this lot out. And if we look at our address decoder there, most of the decoder lines are going to be Y0 to Y6. There is Y7 around here for the ROM, but it probably makes sense to make sure that from the chip point of view that the ABC lines are coming round to the A14, A13 and A12. Remember, we're not using A15 on this particular design. We're only using the bottom 32K of address space. And we probably don't want to go quite up to the end of the breadboard here, because we do want to put the ground rails in. In general, it's always a good idea to leave a bit of a gap between the chips, just because you sometimes have wires that need to go around, and we know that we're going to have three wires from the data pins that you need to come around onto the data bus up here. So perhaps we'll just give that a little bit of a gap. And then we also want to make sure that our VCC, our VSS, can also get directly to ground and plus 5 volts without finding a gap. And there will also be some of the other address lines that are going to go, the A12 and A11 are also going to be going to ground, as we don't need to use the upper 6 kilobytes of ROM. We're going to be forcing it to the bottom 2K. So what we need to work out now is how best to hook up these boards. And what I will do is, I do have a label printer. I will print out some labels to make it clear what these various bus lines are, because I suspect we may become confused quite easily. What I was planning, this is going to be plus and minus supply line, plus and minus supply line. So we'll probably just bridge these over here, and that'll keep the boards together. And then we're going to need to plug A0 down to A11. Are going to want to go down here. And what I was thinking of doing there is, for the moment, just using some jumper cables. The reason being is that in later enhancements to the design, I'd like to add a VGA video card to this. And in order to do that, we are going to need to put some buffer chips on the address and the control and the data lines. And what we'll probably do there is put another breadboard in the middle here with the buffer chips on, which will then drive the bus circuit. So rather than cut lots of wires and have lots of wires going across the two boards like that, I'm just going to use some jumper cables for now, and that will make life a little bit easier. So we're going to have jumper cables down here going down to here, and then we also need to have the D0 to D7 lines going over up here. So I think we might use some jumper cables for that as well for the moment. What I might be inclined to do, once we're doing all the buffer chips, is perhaps to wire in some block of wires up to here and have them go over to the buffer chips that way. But for the moment, we're going to use some rainbow jumper leads like this. I've got a large number of these, and it makes things much easier for hooking things up. And obviously, when we come to tidy things up later, we can then replace these with more permanent wires. So you can see here, I've tidied up the boards a little bit. We've put the dymo labels for the address bus down the bottom for 0 volts and 5 volt rails, so we don't get those confused, and attach those to the CPU board. We've also moved the decoupling capacitors a little bit and tidied up the resistors around the interrupt lines so they're a little bit cleaner and tidier. Now, we also made sure that our address decoder has the power lines for ground and for 5 volts, and that the various lines we need to pull up and pull down have got connections and aren't in a gap between the power rails. And if we look at this chip, we're going to put this with the address bus A0, A1, A2 towards the bottom. But first of all, because the pins are slightly splayed apart, what we need to do is to squash the pins together. And I normally do this just by pushing the pins down on a bit of on the table here, and just do it for each side. And we can just push the pins in so that they're kind of fitting the sockets a little bit cleaner. And you can see there, you see that now the pins, rather being splayed out, will now fit nicely in the socket. Just plug that in there now, make sure it's the right way around. Make sure if we zoom in that we can put it where we've got the necessary 5 volt and 0 volt rails for all the various pins. You can see here the two negative enable pins there, we want to be able to tie to ground easily. So just plug that in there. We're just going to wire in the plus 5 and ground lines first, so put in the plus 5 first and then the ground, and then I'm going to speed up the video as we wire in the other signals, just so that it doesn't take too long to wire all this lot up. So now we're going to connect the two negative enable signals to ground, so they're always enabled, and then the positive enable pin is going to be connected to the E clock signal, and this means that the address decoding output chip enable signals will go low and enable the chips on the rising edge of the E clock signal. It's just wiring the E clock signal up here, just trim the lead down to fit. Tick those off on our diagram. Now we're just going to wire in the read write and the E signal from the CPU up to the bus area where we have the E and read write labels up there. Tick those off. Check everything. Yep, all seems okay. Now we're going to wire in the A12, A13 and A14 lines. So the A12 is on the left hand side of the CPU there. And we're just going to fit this address line. I use green for the address lines generally. So I'll just do those three address lines, and then our address decoder should be fully wired in. We'll wire up the Y1, Y4 and Y7 lines to the other chips when we insert the other chips later. That's the last of the address lines, A14. Let's trim the last little bit. And that should be our address decoder fully done. So just check off the last bits on the diagram. Now we're going to have a look now at the ROM and see what signals and things we need to do for the ROM. So a number of the higher address lines are tied to ground. So what we're going to do first of all is do the power lines, so plus 5, negative. Now we're going to wire the A12 and A11 signals also to ground, so that effectively disables them. They were only going to be using the bottom 2K here, and if we see here, there's also write enable and output enable. So write enable needs to be taken high. That stops it from being programmed, and the output enable will always be low, so that means the output this chip will be dependent on the chip enable signal, not the output enable signal. Now we need to hook up the chip enable signal, which comes from the Y7 line of the address decoder. This means that the ROM is enabled at the 7000 hex address range. We put that onto the chip enable chip select. We might just then put in our decoupling capacitors on the address decoder and the ROM, just put these as close to the ground lines as we can. And now we're going to wire in the address bus to the A0 to A7 lines at the bottom first. So this is a little bit tedious, which is why I've sped it up quite a bit. But what I tend to do is to get two pins side by side going to the same bus rail so that the second wire just comes in over the top of the lower wire. The advantage of this is means that when you've got wires coming in from both chips on the top and the bottom, that you don't run out of address lines when you've got the wires coming up from both the bottom and the top. So we're just going to fit in the rest of these. as we do the last two of the address lines here, you can see that this bit can be a little bit tedious, but compared to designing a printed circuit board and waiting it for it to be manufactured, then I don't believe it's too big a problem. It normally takes about 10 or 15 minutes perhaps to wire in some of these address buses like this, but there's only a handful of these that we need to do. Now we're going to do the higher address lines. So this will be A8, A9 and A10. And those are just going to go from the top of the chip down to the address lines here. And that's one of the reasons why we want to leave a gap between the chips so that we can fit both the address lines from the top down to the bottom here. And also we've got the D0, D1 and D2 data lines that need to go from the bottom of the chip up to the higher area of the bus area. So we've done all the address lines now. Now we're going to look at you doing the data lines. Data lines, I normally use white wire. So we're going to start with the D7 and counting downwards. I normally put in a couple at a time like this and then strip the ends off them. Doesn't really matter which way you do this, but the second one of each one I tend to put a little bit more of a bend in so that sometimes it can go over the end of the lower wire. Now we've done D3 on the end here, we're now just going to wire in the three lower address data lines. That's D2, D1, and then D0. Just tidy up the data lines there, and there we go. So we've finished wiring in the ROM. So now we're going to need to hook up the reset line, and we're also going to connect the non-maskable interrupt and interrupt request lines. So this will allow us to hook in the abort key from the keypad, which goes to non-maskable interrupt, and the interrupt line can be used for peripheral interface adapter, or later we'll add a serial port to this, will allow the serial port to interrupt the CPU. So just checking the configuration of the read write and the e-clock signal, that looks okay. Now we're going to plug in the non-maskable interrupt and the interrupt bus signals and just make sure we connect those up to the right interrupt lines. The fast interrupt request line we're not using in this design at this point in time, just the IRQ and the non-maskable interrupt line. values are okay. Yep, that's fine. So now we need to connect the data bus. So that is D0 down to D7 up onto the data bus. And we're going to get a ribbon cable. Now you'll see in the logic analyzer that there's a particular color sequence here down the bottom, which the logic analyzer uses. And the cables I'm going to use are very similar. The only thing is the gray cable's not quite in the right place, but I'm going to try and use the colors in the same sequence as a data signal. So D0 up to D7 there, you can see. And we're just going to plug that in on the CPU. Speed it up a bit. Be a little bit fiddly, and then just check that's okay. Yep. And then we're going to plug in D0 through to D7 up to the bus signals. Now when we put the buffer chips in here, we'll probably get rid of these ribbon cables and we'll have custom cut wires, but for the moment this makes things much easier. Okay, everything looks okay there. Now we're going to look at the address lines in the same way. Not quite the same color coding for these. But just plug those in and those are going to go to the lower address bus signals. There we go. So starting at the top there is A0. And we're connecting down to A11. These signals. This means that for each of the address decoders there's a 4 kilobyte area for the RAM and the ROM, although for the moment the ROM we're only using. Now what we've done here is disabled the chip select for the ROM. For the moment we're just going to hook up the logic analyzer and we're going to see how the address changes with our no operation code 12hex plugged into the right hand side here. And what the logic analyzer is going to show us is whether the address lines are going up in the sequence we expect, and we're going to look at the Y1 signal. So you can see in our logic analyzer here we're looking at the Y1, Y4, Y7 signals, and we're just going to change this to trigger on the bus status. We're waiting for a trigger. We're going to turn on the power and we can now see that we've got this initial period here for about 100 milliseconds of the reset, and at the moment we can see that the numbers here are not quite what we'd expect, but if we go into the analyzer configuration we can see that we haven't got this configured quite right. We need to turn off the Y1, Y4, Y7 and BS signals. We don't want those appearing in the address decoding. So we're just going to set those bottom lines to none. And that should mean that our values here will be going in the 4 kilobyte range. Turn off the bus status as well. What we should find now when we enabled that is the sequence should be close to what we expect. And remember, it's going to start at 1212 because that's the no operation code that's also the reset vector at the moment. So we expect it to jump up in sequence. And every time the 4K block changes, we're going to see the Y1, Y4 and Y7 signals change. You can see there's a gap for the Y2 and Y3 signals between these, but we can see here that the signals are in fact being enabled in the right address range. And if we zoom right back down here, we click to the beginning of the Y1 range, this is 1000, you can see that it starts at 212 because that's where the address vector was, the reset vector was for 1212, but as we go up to the higher ranges, so if you look at the Y4, this is the 4000 hexadecimal address range. As we get in here, we can see that the lower address signals are going from FFF to 0 as we change over into the new 4K address range. So that looks correct.
And if we just go up to the Y7 range here, which is where the ROM will be enabled, we can then see that that is also being enabled on the boundary of the FFF to 00 transition.
So what we're going to do now is to unplug the no operation code 12 hexadecimal from the data bus. So we'll just unplug the test rig here, move that to one side. And what we're going to do now is to enable the ROM. So we're going to plug this back in. What we're going to do as well is rather than looking at the enable outputs, the Y1, Y4, Y7, what we're going to do is to move this to look at the address lines. So this is just going to be looking at the A12, A13, A14 address lines, and then we're going to move or enable back to Y7 here. We leave the status here. And what we're going to do now is to go back to our logic analyzer. And now we're going to just change these back to A12. A13 and A14. And we're still triggered on bus status. So what we're going to expect now is, because we have enabled the ROM, we would expect to see it loading the reset vector from FF7E, although we'll only see 7FFE because of the we're not using the top A15 address line here. And then we'd expect to see the address counter to start at 7, the vector. Then it's going to move around a little bit. The only thing that won't happen at the moment is when we try and write the stack at the 1300 range, there's no memory there at the moment. So as soon as we try and use the stack, then things will stop working. But we should be able to see the program counter, the address bus, changing around in the 7XX range, and we might also see some 1300 range memory addresses as well. So we're going to run the logic analyzer here and plug in so let's see what we have here. So if we zoom right back out again, and we can see at the beginning here we have our initial period here, about 103 milliseconds, which is our reset period. And if we go to the first byte here, you can see that we've got FFE, but we may not have the address bus quite right here, because we've got FFFE, D89, 8A, 8B. So I don't think we've quite got the address lines right here. But if you remember here, we've got our analyzer here and we need to add the extra address lines into the analyzer. So D12, we're going to make A12, D13, we're going to make A13, and D14, we're going to make A14. There we go. That should mean when it refreshes, there we go. That's what you'd expect. So what we can see here is we start at 7FFF, which is the signal we see on the address bus when the bus is disabled. We then see the first byte of the address vector. And then we see 789, which is the reset vector that we've always looked at. And if we have a look at our ROM here, we can see that the reset vector is 789. Now, in fact, because of the way how the dump of our code here has been done in the ROM, when we want to look at where that is, it's actually in here is 589 here, because the ROM is actually offset from 7800 in the code, which we'll look at when we look at the source code. The first four bytes in the reset code is 10CE13D0. And we can see here, in fact, what we can see is that the address bus progresses up from 7D89A8ACD8F90. It goes to 7FFF, which is the address bus doesn't have a valid address. Then it's looking at it's accessing something in RAM here. Then it carries on 7D. Then the bus is idle for a cycle. And we do something with another area of RAM. And we can see that it carries on down here. And then eventually the code will stop accessing the 7D and 1.3 areas of RAM, because it will then be dependent on values in RAM. And you can see here, after a little while, we then start to look at 0.989. So things start to go astray because we don't have any RAM here. But we can see that the ROM has started the monitor, so we can be fairly sure that this is working reasonably well. Before we end, what I'm just going to do is just to check off the schematic and make sure that we've covered everything. So we know that we've covered the Y signals. We've done all of the 74LS138 signals here. A lot of these are not connected. We know we've connected the Y7 line. We know that A11 is grounded and A12 is grounded, which means this chip is only using 2K of the 8K memory that it has. We have connected the 8 data lines, including the 3 on the other side here. And we've connected the address lines, so A0 to A7. This has all been done. And then the 3 which have come round from the other side here, so A8, A9, and A10. And then we know that A12 and A11 are taken to ground. And finally, output enabled is also grounded, as we have up here. So I'm pretty sure that we have connected all of these things up, and the fact that it's resetting and going through the initial part of the monitor before it becomes dependent on the RAM means that it appears to be working. Now, what I am going to do is to move this board onto a proper breadboard. What I have here is a chopping board or traditional breadboard. This one comes from local supermarket, cost about £6, I think. And to make it easier to move this board around, I'm just going to move our current breadboard circuit onto this board. I may get rid of the plastic at some point in time. So I'll just move that onto there. It makes it a bit easier to maneuver it. I'll just unplug this here. So you can see that you can now move the whole circuit without any major problems out of the way. And we can then see our circuit. So the next stage in the project is going to be adding the RAM and then hook in the PIA. And that will be in the next video. So please hit subscribe if you don't want to miss out any further series. Speak to you shortly. Thanks for watching.